visions during the night continued. I saw one like a son of man coming on the clouds of heaven. When he reached the ancient one and was presented before him, the one like a son of man received dominion, glory, and kingship. All peoples, nations, and languages serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not be taken away. His kingship shall not be destroyed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
say Happy New Year. Because with the first Sunday of Advent, we begin our liturgical year, which means we're ending the year. This is the last Sunday of the church's year, of course, during the week. Monday through Saturday are the last days of that year. But we end with the Feast of Christ the King. I don't know about you, but when I, as an American, when I think of the King, I think of Elvis Presley. As Americans, we don't have much experience with kings and queens. We read about them, we see pictures of them. And really, apart from the Revolutionary War, the idea of king is alien to our experience as Americans. But in the spiritual life, it makes a lot of sense. Christ must have our allegiance. Christ must have our cooperation in every aspect of our lives. Because Jesus really is the Lord and King of our lives. And today's feast helps us to communicate this important truth. And we can reflect upon it. Because in a sense, every night before we go to bed and examine our conscience, we're really reflecting on how much we have acknowledged Christ to be our King, and what we have thought, and what we have done, and the things we have said. When John the Baptist's followers saw Jesus, they asked him, should we follow him or another? And John the Baptist said, he must increase and I must decrease. And that's true of our own lives. Our lives need less of us and more of Jesus. Because as Christians, we shine with reflected light. We are not the source of light. We shine with reflected light, the light of Christ, the grace of the Holy Spirit. And in that way, we can make the good news of the gospel attractive to others. This is what St. Paul means when he writes, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. When we're baptized, we put on Christ, much the way we put on a set of clothes. We are robed in the identity of Christ, where God the Father sees and loves in us, after baptism, what he sees and loves in Christ his Son. So that's why we're called Christians. We are other Christs. And Christ is indeed to be the Lord of our lives. If we were to use the image of a house, I think we would be able to say that Christ is our King if we would admit him into every single room of the house. Because it's in the rooms of the house where our lives are lived. Now, of course, some people are content to give Christ access to the hallways, but not to all the rooms. And they try to keep Christ in the hallway and out of all the rooms. We can ask ourselves the question, how is Jesus the King of our family life? Well, we know that we're all made in the image and likeness of God, and indeed we put on Christ and should see Christ in each other. And how important that is, that every member of our family be a focus for our respect and dignity. You know, our default position with regard to anybody in our family should be one of generosity and compassion. We might ask ourselves, now how is Jesus the Lord of my main preoccupation, whether that's a career, a profession, a job, whether a full-time student? Is Jesus King of that? And I think we would have to say, you know, whether we're talking about the classroom, or whether we're talking about the place where we work, that we can't be involved in immoral and unethical practices and strategies. Certainly in school we try to do our own work and be honest about taking tests. The same thing is true in the workplace. Now, there are times when, you know, certainly as a priest, certainly priests hear this, where a person will say that they really can't stand what's going on at work with the strategies and the underhanded practices. And frankly, the defrauding customers. And sometimes we at least have to raise our voice against these things. Sometimes we have to walk away. Do our co-workers, do our fellow students know that we're Catholic? Is there anything about us that would suggest that we are Christian? And more specifically, Catholic Christian? I think that's something important for us to consider. You know, that if we wear the cross around our neck or from our earlobes, it's not just a piece of jewelry. You know, it's supposed to mean something. It means, indeed, if we have a sense of integrity, that Christ is indeed Lord of my life. Now, we might ask again, how is Jesus king of my personal life? And again, we can go back to the image of a house. Now, would you be comfortable having Christ standing next to you, observing everything you do, 24 hours a day? Or are there times you would not want him around? Now, if we're not comfortable with this thought, then we have to wonder how much Christ really is the king of our lives. And, of course, in the personal way, it's important to have steady contact with Christ through prayer. Now, Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Jesus is my friend. How often do I talk to Jesus? Now, if you have a best friend, you talk to him or her quite a bit. And if we are indeed turning to Jesus each day in conversation and in prayer, then that tells us that God, that Jesus matters to us. But, you know, if we go through the whole day without praying, then Jesus certainly was not king of that day in our lives. And if we turn our thoughts and minds to God when we come to Mass, perhaps for 1 hour of 168 a week, one cannot say with honesty that Jesus is Lord of that week. How is Jesus king of my mind? Do we reflect about our faith and read about it? There are so many resources, not just books, there's all kinds of websites so that we can learn about our faith. There's, of course, the Bible, my gosh. You can't go wrong by reading the Bible. Spirit will inform you with light and direction. Now, are we competent defenders of our faith and our church? These are frequently challenged. Of course, we can shrink back and lose our nerve because we have nothing really to say. In what way do we exercise and apply our minds so that we can understand our faith and explain it adequately to others? You know, we celebrate confirmation at the cathedral, and during my homily at confirmation, you know, I asked the candidates not to consider their reception of confirmation as their Catholic graduation ceremony. Right, because I was a pastor for 7 years, and when I was kids, I never saw it. Right, and so, yet many Catholics are comfortable settling for a grade school level of faith. You know, after confirmation, that's about it. Religious formation stops in the teen years. Would Catholics be satisfied with a sixth grade level of math, or science, or literature, or history, or economics? I don't think so. And what we know or don't know about our faith can point out to what degree Christ is king of our life. So today's feast presents us with an opportunity to take stock and to reflect on our priorities and where God and Jesus, his son, fits into them. You know, we can open the doors of every room of our house, of every room of our lives, for Christ to abide and dwell there. We can view the members of our family with a sense of generosity, respect, and seeing them the face of Christ. We can allow Christ to accompany us when we leave the house to go to school or to work, and to witness to the difference that his love makes in our lives. And we can speak to Jesus in regular prayer. We can encounter him in the sacraments. And we can continue to grow in our faith by our efforts to know that faith and the Bible, so that with God's grace we can be witnesses and advocates for the new evangelization, the conversion and change of heart that is so important for the spread of the gospel. My brothers and sisters, when we accept Christ as our King, everything in our life changes. May the Spirit guide us in the ways that will open our hearts to Christ, who is our King.
Thank you.
days. That by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace in unity in accordance with your will, to live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
receive the food of immortality. We ask, O Lord, that glorying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May we see you, please.
Good morning, friends and family of St. James. I'm Jim Bolger, a member of the Long Range Planning Committee, and I'll be your MC today for our festivities. Before we begin the formal program, just have an announcement. As you know, St. James is a very loving, caring community, and we have Giving Tree going on. Two things. All your gifts are due today. Make sure your gifts are due today. And we need volunteers at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Bring boxes up from downstairs. Thank you. It's wonderful that you're all here to participate in the dedication ceremonies for our new parish ministry and Mary Garden. On behalf of your St. James Parish family, I wish to extend a special and spiritual welcome to our Bishop, David Walkowiak. One of the many responsibilities of the Bishop is to provide spiritual and administrative leadership for all parishes within the diocese. And for here at St. James, the Bishop has provided us with guidance and support. And one of his responsibilities is the facilities. Bishop and his staff have been extremely supportive and helpful as we engage in our planning, financing, and construction for both projects. Thank you, sir. We are grateful for your continued support for your St. James Parish family. I'd like to ask Paul Martin, the chair of the Long Range Planning Committee, to come forward to say a few words of thanksgiving.
The Holy Spirit is alive here at St. James Catholic Church. We are so grateful that you are all here to celebrate the blessing of our new ministry rooms and our Mary Garden. We are anxious for you to see the beautiful and very functional rooms, but we are really excited to see what's going to happen next, all the wonderful new programs and ministries now that we have this space. This has been a 4-year project with many, many people contributing to make it a success. On behalf of the Long-Term Planning Committee, we would like to make some important thank yous. Bishop Walkowiak, thank you again for allowing us to do this project. We are grateful for all the guidance and support that we have received from the diocese. To Father Don, for having the vision to reestablish the Long-Term Planning Committee, and Father Peter, who was thrown head-on into this project, we are thankful for your support and your daily walkthroughs. To the Breton Group, who helped with our vision, to our architects, from Concept Design Studio, Kevin and Kyle Wusterhart. They have listened to our ministries, who have provided direction and counsel. They design and listen and redesign over and over again until our plan was just perfect. After 4 years of partnership, we feel like you are family. During this time, Kevin and his wife had a baby boy. Kyle had just gotten married, and now we have 6-month-old Claire joining the family. We're so glad you're all here, and we really love you. To Muskegon Quality Builders, led by Tom Grimm, and our amazing construction manager, Mike Kozicki. You have done a first-class job on this project. Tom has worked so hard to keep this project in budget, encouraging many of the subcontractors to do extras for free gratis. We thank all of our subcontractors, especially our parishioners. By the way, Mike and his wife are expecting their first son in March. Being around us Catholics must be rubbing off on this, guys. To our past and present office staff, we have gone way above and beyond the call of duty, especially Pat Jackson, who has been the glue that has held this staff together, and she did it with grace and a smile, as always. To Ronnie Flynn and Stan Witkowski for all the extra work involved with the construction project. We didn't have to ask. You just did it. To the Capitol Campaign Committee and all of the many volunteers, we could not have done this without your dedication and hard work. To the group that took on the project of relocating and building the beautiful Mary Garden, what a special tribute to our Blessed Mother. To John Duff, who has done anything and everything that has needed to be done. Thanks to him, we are online and connected. But really, above all, we want to share our gratitude to you, our entire parish. Each and every one of you has made a difference. Your prayers, your financial support, your positive comments have kept us inspired. Your constructive criticism has made us think and kept us on our toes. Here at St. James, we are a family. We laugh together, we cry together, we support each other, we grow in faith, we pray together, we disagree, but we forgive each other. But above all things, we love each other. 1 Corinthians 13 says, "Now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. The greatest commandment is love the Lord God above all, and love thy neighbor." And that, my dear friends, is what this is all about.
Thank you, Paula. As Paula mentioned, our committee relied on the guidance and counsel of the Holy Spirit as we performed our responsibilities. We are very thankful for the gifts of wisdom, knowledge, and fortitude that our Holy Spirit has provided to all of you who have contributed so much to the success of our parish undertakings. As you know, every earthly plan needs an earthly leader to follow the concepts of many into successful completion of a project. Thank you, Paula, for making this happen for us. When you tour the ministry center, please take note of the great functionality of all the ministry spaces. This is based upon the input we receive from all our ministries based on their future projected needs. You'll also notice that the new rooms are not named, and your old rooms still have their numbers on them. We're asking that each member of the ministries pray and reflect on what would be an appropriate saint's name or biblical passage for the rooms. And based upon this mission, a name for each of these rooms will be selected. So put on your thinking caps and ask guidance from the Holy Spirit in the naming of our rooms. At the conclusion of our Eucharistic celebration, Bishop Walkowiak will lead us in procession to our beautiful Mary Garden, and then proceed to the west entrance of the new parish ministry center for the formal dedication, blessing, and ribbon cutting. Upon completion of our tour, we will exit the main entrance of the center and return to our parish hall at lunch. We invite all those who can, please join us. And for those of you who would rather wait for our return, we ask that you either stay here in church or in the parish hall, as the narthex will be set up for our luncheon. And the children, as you exit, see Pat Jackson, and she'll take care of the kids. We hope that you're all able to join us for fellowship. And as you leave church today, or join us on the procession, be careful, there's a couple icy spots, so try to salt them, but be careful. And Father Peter, thank you for your continued spiritual guidance and support for all the members of our St. James family. God bless you. God bless you all.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Paula. The welcome address presented to Bishop Walkowiak. John Maxwell said, "Coming together is the beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. And so it takes a teamwork to make the dream work." We as a parish was confronted with a problem of space for our kids and different ministries we have in our parish. We did not shy away from the program, but with great attitude, we turned our problems into blessings. We turned our difficulties into opportunities. And today, we are celebrating our success. Thanks to all of you for making our dream come true. To our beloved Bishop Walkowiak, since you came to this diocese, we have been longing to see you, and today you are here. The weather is cool, but our hearts are warm. Welcome to our parish. What a wonderful thing to have you in our midst on the last Sunday of this liturgical year. St. James Montague, our leader of Assumption Rothbury, St. John's Claybanks, are all welcoming communities. During the summer, we have so many friends, so many people visiting our churches. People from Chicago, Florida, New York, Washington, Ohio, other parts of Michigan, Canada, and Germany. They always leave our parishes with smiles, and we hope you will do the same today. To our priests and deacons, Father Don, Father Norm, Father Bart, and Deacon Greg, thanks to all of you for the services you render in our parishes. To the choir, to all the servers, to all the decorators, you've made today a special day. And to all those that have worked hard to see to the success of today's event, I say, may God bless you all. Again, to our beloved Bishop, welcome to our parish. And we always say, come again and again and again, because we love you.
I'm no longer never at a loss for words. Now, first of all, I think Father Peter and Tim and Paula covered the waterfront. I'm thanking everybody, especially you. I can't help but thinking, though, that when this project started, I was happily the pastor of St. John of our church in Chagrin Falls, Ohio, 4 years ago. I'm very happy to be your bishop, but it just shows you, certainly it's been a lot has happened to me while your project was unfolding, and I'm very happy to be here, first of all. I think that we give Bishop Hurley a little assist, or at least a little remembrance. He was the bishop, I must believe, who had approved this project, and Father John, of course, had the vision. And I am so happy to hear that all of you kind of honed it, the model, so that it's exactly what you need. That's the kind of what you need from our parishioners. Also, I want to commend Father Peter, because I do know, coming in as a new pastor with a project already underway, it can be somewhat unsettling. You have to try to look, should we really be doing this? Is this the right way to go? And just try to get your bad reminder on what the parish is planning. So I want to commend him for that. Fumbling the ball, but carrying it through to completion, and I think that's so important. Obviously, I've seen your new facilities, and they're just what the Lord would order in order for you to show your vibrancy and your desire to participate in new evangelization. And I cannot help but think about Mary's garden, you know, our Holy Father Pope Francis's emphasis on ecology and the environment. And I have to believe that a beautiful garden will help us to realize that we're all joined together, not only as members of the human family, but as members of creation, all that God has created. So I'm certainly hoping that not only meditation, but also lifting one's mind and heart to God, but just enjoying the beauty of creation that God has given to all of us, you now have a very special place at the church to do that. Finally, I would like you to pray for those parishes that have special projects going on. I'm happy to be here on this red letter day where you are actually blessing and really reveling in the gorgeous work that's been done and all that's been accomplished. We still have parishes that are struggling to make their goals in terms of financially so they can get going. And some, have had to go back to the drawing board, in terms of their plans. So in the spirit of generosity, I hope you'll remember those other communities of faith through their dioceses, trying to accomplish what you have accomplished. And to add your prayer so that people will open their hearts with generosity and interest and really help to make them the communities of faith that they need to be. So thank you very much, and we'll now have God's blessing. Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Your continuous work begets in us every measure of desire and achievement. We bless you for setting our hearts on heaven during our pilgrim days on earth. Grant to your servants who will use these rooms these blessings. Listen to you in faith, speak to you in prayer, to seek only you in all their work, and to find you in all that they do, to become witnesses to the gospel. Through them,
spread the good fragrance of Christ everywhere until the day they rejoice in the revelation of his glory, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever.
Amen.
Grateful for those who have provided this meal, those who will prepare and serve it,
as we ask your blessing upon this food which we will now eat and the time we spend together through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Bon appétit.
Is it?